First, to introduce myself, I am Dr. K. Deepanjan. I am assistant professor at the Department of History at Tetzo College, and I will be the moderator for today's talk for the webinar. And I am extremely pleased and delighted to have Professor Chinnarao as the speaker for today's Professor Yagati Chinnarao as the speaker for today's talk. I also welcome our head of our department, Dr. Tatongkala, who is also present with us, and I welcome other faculty and students of other departments who have joined for the talk. And to briefly introduce Professor Chinnarao. Professor Yagati Chinnarao is a chairperson at the Center for Study of Social Exclusion and Inclusive Policy at Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. He was formerly the member secretary of Indian Council of Historical Research and also lecturer at the K.R. Narayanan Center for Dalit and Minority Studies at Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. He has held various teaching positions in different universities across the in India and abroad. To name a few, he was visiting professor at Kaunas Technical University, Lithuania, Instituto Italiano di Studi Orientali, Rome, Italy, Nelson Mandela Metropolitan University at South Africa, School of Humanities and Social Sciences at Jacobs University, Bremen, Germany, visiting fellow at the Institute of Advanced Studies in the Humanities and Center for South Asian Studies, University of Edinburgh, Scotland. And in India also, he is a visiting professor at the Nehru Studies Center, Madurai Kamraj University, Sri Shankaracharya University, Kaledi, Department of History, University of Calcutta, and the list is quite long and it goes on. So these are some of the positions he hold. And he, apart from this, he has authored and edited monographs of books of more than 15, and he has journal articles of more than 30. Okay, and apart from this, he has delivered keynote addresses, presidential addresses, and lectures in number of conferences in India and abroad. And he holds and he is membership of various professional bodies and organizations of various reputed institutions in India. Okay. And his research interests include Dalit studies, discrimination and exclusion, history of education, affirmative action, and human rights. Okay. So this was a brief, very, very, very brief bio note of Professor Yagati Chinnarao. And it's a very long and illustrious CV of his all the years of academic experience and academic profile and experience. And personally, for me, it gives me immense pleasure to have him as the to have him for the lecture in our department, because he was my PhD supervisor at Jawaharlal Nehru University, JNU. And it is a personally an immense pleasure to have him here. And thank you, sir, for accepting the invite for delivering the lecture for Department of History at Tetzo College. Not taking much more of your time. So I would request Professor Yagati Chinnarao to start with the proceedings. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Deepanjan, for that generous introduction. So now that we are in academics, so we have to do our business. It's nothing great that I have done. So I try to do some research on my area. And good afternoon to you all. And at the very outset, I thank the organizers, Department of History, Tetzo College, Dimapur, and for extending the invitation. And to deliver this lecture, and I'm not an authority on the subject, but I make use of this opportunity to share some of my research ideas which developed during last 2.5 decades or so. So the and some of you may be too familiar with these ideas, and please bear with me if you feel like it's a repetition for you. And after completing my presentation and any question answers, I'm happy to respond. My present today's lecture generally deals with the debates centered around the concept of social exclusion, which has become central to the newer discipline that has in recent years gained significance within social sciences in India and predicated on vigorous intercontinental and interdisciplinary framework. This discipline, still in its formative stage, has immense potential in crucial revisionist interventions in exploring and conceptualizing political economy and statist interventions in relation to groups excluded and marginalized in different forms of traditional structures and modern practices of governmentality that have subjected to many omissions in traditional disciplines. It's also significant to the possibilities it offers in understanding the challenges from the peripheries and the bottom, and a deeper engagement with the epistemic modes vital to critical re-examination of ideological underpinnings and the political structures and the processes, especially given the wide reckoning of the inherent relationship between cognitive justice and social justice. In this presentation, my lecture locates the framing of the concept of social exclusion with the broader context while paying attention to its grounding within the Indian context and in relation to the particular mode of exclusion of the largest marginalized groups in India, that is Dalits, which constitutes 18% of the Indian population. The social exclusion is construed as denial of equal opportunities imposed by some groups of the society on certain groups, leading to a state of inability to an individual to participate in the basic political, economic, and social functioning of this society. The term social exclusion is so evocative, ambiguous, multidimensional, and expansive that it can be defined in different ways. Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Fine, thank you. So, however, the difficulty of defining exclusion and the fact that is interpreted differently in different contexts at different times is a theoretical opportunity. Rather than single definition of exclusion, it is interesting to understand the disputes surrounding the term exclusion, that its usage in different contexts, by tracing the history of the idea and decoding the multiple meanings of the term. The term social exclusion is, as it is foregrounded, emerged in the late 20th century in Europe as a key concept among analysts and policymakers seeking to understand and formulate directives of approaches to alleviate some of the negative social effects of economic restructuring. Thus, the term has an evident appeal for politicians and policy analysts. In Western Europe, those meanings are embedded in the emergence of the term in French political rhetoric and specific institutional history of the European Union. The term social exclusion was originally coined in France in 1974. It refers to various categories of people who were not protected by social insurance at the time and labeled as social problems and identified as mentally and physically handicapped, suicidal people, aged invalids, abused children, substance abusers, delinquents, single parents, and multi-problem households, marginal, asocial persons, and other social misfits. However, in the 1980s, this stigmatizing and narrow view of social exclusion was superseded as the term became central to French debates about the nature of neo-poverty associated with technological change and economic restructuring. Social exclusion in this context was not simply equated with poverty, but broadened to refer to a process of social disintegration in the sense of a progressive rupture of the relationship between individual and society, which was occurring due to increasing long-term unemployment, particularly unskilled workers and immigrants, and the inability of young people to enter the labor market, greater family instability and isolated single-member households, increasing number of homeless people, rising tensions and periodic violence in the low-cost housing settlements on the peripheries of cities, what we call in Indian context, juggies in the cities, and this dissipation of the social fabric of society seemed to be consequence of the long-term process of transformations in the structure and organization of economic life. The social exclusion and its theories and models. There are five models or theories that are available to us and mostly developed while studying the racial discrimination in United States by the economists to begin with and later joined by the psychologists. The methodology that was employed to study the racial discrimination was applied to study the caste discrimination in India. What is the rationale for upper caste discrimination against Dalits? The theories that are available to us.
Excuse me, sorry to intervene, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, do you want to present the PPT?
If it is required, not otherwise. Not for myself.
Yeah, okay, sir. Sorry.
Okay, if the audience wanted, you can do that.
Okay. Thank you. Sorry for the disturbance.
No problem. So in 1957, Gary Becker offered a rationale in response to a similar question that the racial discrimination, that the white males discriminate against their black counterparts because of they have a taste for discrimination from which they derive utility, and this taste emanates from prejudices that an individual from one group holds against individual of another group, in this case, blacks and women. The Gary Becker, his full name Gary Stanley Becker, was an American economist and an empiricist. He was awarded Nobel Prize for Economics in 1992 and received United States Presidential Medal for Freedom. Becker was one of the first economists to branch into what were traditionally considered topics that belongs to sociology, that is, including racial discrimination, crime, and drug addiction, etc. Becker wrote his dissertation in 1955 at the University of Chicago, which examined the economics of discrimination. At that time, economics was strictly study of market behavior and market economies. Becker challenged the past era of economics by bringing the new investigation of social matters of economics. Becker's contribution to discrimination was unpopular with the people arguing that his theory was not part of an economics. So after Becker, in 1973, Kenneth Arrow formulated the belief theory to grasp the validation of discrimination. People discriminate because they believe or perceive that people from another group are, on an average, less productive, and therefore they make their decisions about hiring and wages for the other group members based on their belief, which may be wrong and may result in discriminatory outcome. Followed by Becker and Kenneth Arrow, in 2010, another theory put forward by George Zakharlov along with Rachel Cranton brought into the social category or social identities and their norms into realm of economic decisions. The identity theory postulates that cultural norms determine how individuals in the social group behave towards others as individual choices are socially framed. In its application to race and poverty, the identity theory implies that the behavior of whites towards blacks is determined by group norms which perpetuate distinction of us and them. The white thinks of blacks as them rather than including them in the category of us all. This division norms based on us and them are what others call it oppositional identity, results in discrimination. All these three theories, the taste, belief, and identity theories, that discrimination results from prejudice, which is embedded in an individual psychology. Social psychologists have also provided further insights into the causes of prejudice and motive of discrimination. Gordon Allport treats prejudice primarily as something which is rooted in the individual psychology. The psychology of prejudice produces stereotypical, that is the false beliefs among the dominant group and the discriminatory behavior towards the subordinate group, a view that is similar to taste theory. Herbert Bloomer questions Allport's theoretical construct of prejudice as a set of individual feelings and argues that race prejudice exists in the sense of group position rather than in a set of individual feelings which members of one racial group have towards members of another racial group. Bloomer shifts the locus of the origin of prejudice from individual belief to attitudes of the group about the relative status and material benefits associated with the membership in the group harboring stereotypical beliefs towards the other. The extent to which the dominant groups perpetuate advantage for their own and disadvantage for the subordinate groups is a crucial factor for the group outcomes. In Bloomer's notion of prejudice, there are four basic types of feelings or attitudes that always seem to be present in the race prejudice by the dominant group: a sense of superiority, a feeling that subordinate race is intrinsically different and alien, a feeling of proprietary claim to certain areas of privilege and disadvantage and advantage, and perhaps the most important, a feeling of, you know, fear that subordinate race harbors designs on the prerogatives of the dominant race. Thus, Bloomer shifts the axis of prejudice away from individual sentiments towards the collective interests of the collective interests in maintaining a relative group interest. The focus is on group position and a group efforts rather than an individual for material interest and high social status. Hence, prejudice becomes an operative mobilizing instrument for preserving the advantaged position of the dominant group. There are real materialist interests at the stake in the effort to the dominant group to preserve its privileged position, and also the more intangible and psychic benefit of the high status advantage. Building on this, William Darity and others brought further insights to the role of economic or material interest in shaping the racial identity norms. Racial identity norms shaped by the relative income gains from racial or non-racial or mixed strategy in social interaction. Identity norms determined by the relative income gains are the productivity of identity norms in social interaction from each of the identity norms. The most significant aspect of this theory is that by bringing the relative income gains into the norm formation of racist, secular, and mixed identity in social interactions, and it captures the underlying conditions that brings change from racial norms to individual norms or non-racist norms and mixed norms of discrimination and makes the theory dynamic in nature. All these propounded theories suggest that social exclusion and discrimination is a group concept based on group identities such as race, color, religion, ethnicity, caste, or gender. In the case of group exclusion, all individuals from the group are excluded due to their social identity, irrespective of the economic standing of an individual within a social group, thereby making discrimination is neutral to economic status. For instance, what we call scheduled castes or untouchables face discrimination based on their caste identity, irrespective of their financial status, as the people belonging to higher castes do not make any distinction between the economically weak and better off among the discriminated group. Therefore, policies to provide safeguards against discrimination, such as reservations, are based on the social identity of the group rather than that of an individual. If the discrimination is neutral to economic status, the criteria for legal safeguards and policies have to be caste and not economic status of the individual within the group. Addressing social exclusion requires a holistic approach which promotes the involvement of excluded populations in community life, ensuring access to basic services, promote behavioral change, increase in income, and address other key elements of exclusion. Discrimination is a particular kind of exclusion and that can take either an active or a passive form. Active exclusion through discrimination will see agents systematically refusing to hire or accept the participation of members of a social group despite their formal qualifications or even our qualifications for sometimes, while routinely favoring members of a group who are equally or even less qualified. The consequences of this discrimination can lead to deprivation indirectly. The passive discrimination, in which the discouragement and lower self-confidence result in poor performance, or through direct routes that limit access to income or education, that is mobility enhancing. In the social science literature, there is a general agreement that the core features of social exclusion, its principal indicators, and the way it relates to poverty and inequality. The developments in social science literature enables us to comprehend the meanings and manifestations of the concept of social exclusion and its applicability to caste and ethnicity-based exclusion in India. The concept of social exclusion thus essentially refers to the process through which groups are wholly or partially excluded from full participation in the society in which they live. It emphasizes two crucial dimensions involving the notion of exclusion, namely the societal institutions of exclusion and their outcome in terms of deprivation. To understand the dimensions of exclusion, it is necessary to explore the societal interrelations and institutions which lead to the exclusion of certain groups and a deprivation in multiple spheres, that is civil, cultural, political, and economic. Thus, for a better understanding of the concept of exclusion, the sight into the societal processes and institutions of exclusion are as important as the outcome in terms of deprivation for certain groups. Amartya Sen refers to various meanings and manifestations of social exclusion, particularly concerning the causes or the process of discrimination and deprivation in a given society. Exclusion could occur through direct exclusion, violating fair norms of exclusion, that is unfavorable exclusion, or through inclusion, but under unfavorable conditions, again, violating fair norms of exclusion, that is unfavorable inclusion, or through deliberate government policies, that is active exclusion, and through unintended attempts and circumstances, or exclusion caused through inability of some persons when compared to other persons. The mainstream economics have further elaborated the concept of discrimination that operates particularly through markets. Social exclusion can occur in variety of ways that it is important to recognize the versatility of the idea and its reach. The social exclusion in Indian context. In India, exclusion is embedded in societal interrelations and institutions that exclude, discriminate, isolate, and deprive some groups based on groups' identities, such as caste and ethnicity. The nature of exclusion revolving around the caste system particularly needs to be understood and conceptualized. The fundamental characteristics of the caste system is based on fixed civil, cultural, and economic rights of each caste, which restricts for change implying forced exclusion on one caste from the rights of another caste or from undertaking the occupations of other castes. Exclusion and discrimination in civil, cultural, particularly economic sphere, such as occupation and labor employment, is therefore internal to the system and a necessary outcome of its governing principles. In the market economy framework, the occupational immobility would operate through restrictions in various markets, such as land, labor, credit, and other inputs, and services necessary for any other economic activity. Labor being an integral part of the production process of any economic activity would obviously suffer market discrimination. The caste identity, however, has been a dominant factor in the discourse of social exclusion. The social stigmatization of Dalits, the unique characteristic of the caste identity, makes them vulnerable to the social exclusion in multiple realms of the society. They suffer the most from the unequal assignment, entitlement of rights and opportunities. The opportunities including physical, social segregation, denial of freedom, restricted social participation, and deprivation of many social privileges. In the course of fulfilling their rights and privileges, they often experience caste-based discrimination and violence. These human rights violations have been an endemic feature of Indian society and have identified several debates, initiated several debates and discussions in the contemporary India. Amartya Sen draws attention to various meanings and dimensions of the concept of social exclusion. He draws a distinction between situations where some people are kept out or left out, and where some people are included forcibly, deeply unfavorable terms. As mentioned earlier, the two situations are described as unfavorable exclusion and unfavorable inclusion, namely through differential treatment in terms of conditions of contract, which would reflect the discrimination in the prices charged and received by the discriminated groups. This can be inclusive of the price of a factor inputs, consumer goods, prices of factor production, such as wages for labor, value of land or rent on land, interest in capital, rent on residential houses, charges or fee on services such as water and electricity. Discriminated groups can get lower prices for the goods they sell and could pay higher prices for the goods they buy as compared with the market price or the prices paid by other groups. Amartya Sen argues that it is important to distinguish between active exclusion, that is, fostering of exclusion through deliberate policy of interventions by the government or by any other willful agents to exclude some people from from some opportunity, and the passive exclusion, which works through the social processes in which there are no deliberate attempts to exclude, but may result in exclusion from a set of circumstances. Sen further distinguishes the constitutive relevance of exclusion from that of instrumental importance. In the former, exclusion or a deprivation have an intrinsic importance of their own. For instance, not being able to relate to others or take part of life of the community can directly impoverish person's life. In addition to the further deprivation it may generate, this is different from social exclusion of instrumental importance, where the exclusion itself is not impoverishing but can lead to impoverishment of human life. Secondly, the exclusion and discrimination can occur in terms of access to social needs supplied by the government or public institutions, or by private institutions in education, housing, and health, including common resources such as water bodies, grazing land, and any other land of common use. Fourthly, the group, particularly these untouchables, face discrimination from participation in certain categories of jobs, as the sweeper being excluded from inside household jobs, because the notion of purity and pollution of occupations and their engagement in so-called unclean occupations. To sum up this argument, the major fields are agents through which the Dalits face exclusion. In the civil and cultural spheres, untouchables face discrimination and exclusion in use of public services, roads, temples, water bodies, and institutions delivering services, education, health, and other public services. In the political spheres, untouchables face discrimination on account of political rights and participation in decision-making process. Due to the physical or residential segregation and social exclusion on account of the notion of untouchability, they suffer from a general societal exclusion. Since there is a societal mechanism to regulate, enforce the customary norms of rules of caste system, the untouchables generally face opposition in the form of social and economic boycott, violence, which acts as a general deterrent to their right to development. Amongst the marginal groups, although the scheduled castes and scheduled tribes are worse off in terms of deprivation, caste identity in particular has fundamentally worked against the scheduled castes in many spheres of social life in mainstream society. Unlike scheduled tribes, the scheduled castes mostly live in the mixed caste villages in the mainstream society and remain vulnerable to discriminatory practices based on group identity. Despite the constitutional safeguards and specific legislative measures to address the issue of discrimination based on caste identity, the exclusionary nature of social relations continues to persist as far as the scheduled castes are considered. The prevalence of caste-based discrimination and other related oppressive behaviors often restrict their access to opportunities and push them into the morass of socially excluded life. There are numerous research studies and experimental accounts to suggest that the lack of equal access to essential public resources and services among the scheduled castes is not always accidental, but an outcome of active social discrimination at the societal as well as the institutional level. Historically, the caste system classified people into their occupations, and status of each caste had a specific place in the hierarchy of social status. Baba Saheb Dr. B.R. Ambedkar described caste as a hoary institution, which is familiar and unexplained in nature. Ambedkar challenged some of the established scholars of the time, particularly on the category of caste. According to a French Indologist, Emile Senart says, caste is a close, traditional, and independent organization, which comprises chief and a council, in which the members are linked by similar occupations and they gather during festivals. At the same time, they have a particular notions of marriage, food, ceremonial pollutions. Senart argued that the process particular jurisprudence, which maintains power through penalties over its members, and those who do not obey those codes of law are excluded from that group. On the other hand, John Nesfield interprets caste as a class of a community which disowns any connection with other class and can neither intermarry, eat, nor drink with any but persons of their own community. Sir Herbert Risley argues that the caste may be defined as a collection of families or a group of families, and bearing a common name, which usually denotes or associated with a specific occupation, claiming common descendant from a mythical ancestor, human or a divine. S.V. Kaitkar defines caste as a social group having two characteristics. Membership is confined to those who are born members of and include all persons are so born. And the other definition is members are forbidden by an inexorable social law to marry outside the group. Ambedkar asserted that aforementioned views on caste reduced to an isolated unit and failed to explore relations within the whole system of caste. Ambedkar questioned Senat's view by asserting that the idea of pollution is linked to priestly ceremonialism and it will remain as a feature of caste till caste maintains its religious flavor. Ambedkar also scrutinized Nesfield for not analyzing the exclusiveness related to caste and lamented that Nesfield has mistaken the effect for the cause. For Ambedkar, Kaitkar misconceived the prohibition of intermarriage and membership by auto agency as two separate characteristics, which are the observers and reserves sides of the same model, because if you prohibit intermarriage, the result is that you limit membership to those born within the group. Despite too many disagreements with Kaitkar, Ambedkar appreciates him as one scholar who tried to explore the caste system and emphasized on prohibition of intermarriage as the essence of caste. And Ambedkar elucidates that caste in India means an artificial chopping off the population into fixed definite units, each one preventing from focusing into another through custom of endogamy. Thus, the conclusion is inevitable that endogamy is the only characteristic that is peculiar to caste. And if we succeed in showing how endogamy is maintained, we shall practically have proved the genesis and also the mechanism of caste. However, since the 19th century, the link between caste and occupation has become less rigid, and it became easier for people to change occupations. And this change accelerated with an economic boom, which has taken place in India since the early 1990s. Legally, untouchability in India was prohibited by the Constitution of India. To give an effect to this article, Parliament enacted an Untouchability Offences Act in 1955. Based on Article 1917, Abolition of Untouchability, its provisions are implemented by the respective state governments and union territories and coordinated by the Government of India. The Act provides penalties for enforcing untouchability or any disability arising thereof, like, for instance, preventing a person from entering a place of public worship and offering prayers or taking water from sacred tank, well, or spring. To make this provisions of this Act more stringent, the Act was amended in 1976, was also renamed as Protection of Civil Rights Act 1955, and the government also notified the PCR rules and 19 to carry out the provisions of this Act. As the cases of atrocities on scheduled castes were not covered under the provisions of PCR Act of 1955, and Parliament passed another Act in 1989 to take measures to prevent the atrocities committed against them. This act, known as Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes Prevention of Atrocities Act 1989, became effective from January 30, 1990. For carrying out the provisions of this act, the Government of India notified the Scheduled Castes and Scheduled Tribes of Prevention of Atrocities Act rules on March 31, 1995. And these rules were amended and amended and amended. And finally, the last amendment came in December 2015. Cases also go unreported owing to the dependency of Dalit communities for their livelihood and the fear of backlash by the perpetrators as they hold social, economic, and institutional power in the area. Dalit victims also do not receive any kind of support from the police or administration to register human rights violation against them. From its review with various state governments and scheduled tribe commissions, viewed that a large number of cases of atrocities go unregistered, mainly because of reluctance on the part of police officers to register the cases. The notions of purity and pollution have been particularly resilient in relation to drinking water resources. The studies also confirmed that found that the persistent conflicts were reported with regard to drinking water, while complete denial of access to particular water source that could be a well, tank, tube well, and so on, designated as upper caste water source, was quite common. What was even more common was that imposition of differential behaviors on Dalits. In our one third, that is about 36% of the villages surveyed, the Dalits were denied entry into village shops. This usually meant that the Dalits were not allowed to come up to the counter to other customers, but were made to wait outside or at some distance from the shop. In about one third of the villages, the tea shops discriminate Dalits against Dalits by asking them to be seated separately, and widespread practice of two glass system. The social status of the caste providing services such as washermen and barbers is dependent on their denying the services to Dalits. Such denial of services to Dalits is always demanded by non-Dalits. Discrimination by washermen and barbers were found present in as many as 47% of the villages. This was not 19th century or 20th century I'm talking about. This is in the 21st century, where 47% of the villages, barbers and dobis doesn't extend their services to Dalits. The caste system is based on deprivation and division of people into social groups to which civil, cultural, economic rights of each caste are predetermined or hereditary. The indicators and forms of stigmatization that social exclusion takes on has been described, taking a historical case of Peshwa rule by Ambedkar in his paper Annihilation of Caste. He points out that under the Peshwa rules, the Maratha country, the untouchables were not allowed to use public streets if a Hindu was coming along, lest he not pollute the Hindu by his even shadow. Discrimination in schools take the form of denial of access to education and skill development among the Dalit children. This reduces to quality of human resources and employability for quality jobs and force them to rely on low-earning manual wage labor in farming and non-farming activities. Denial of education leads to increased illiteracy, low functional literacy, high dropout rates, and limited skill development, and discrimination in education leads to high representation of menial jobs, low wages, low income, and ultimately high poverty. The Dalits were prevented from, in 25% of villages, Dalits are prevented from entering into ration shops. In 33% of the villages, public health workers refused to visit Dalit homes. In 14% of the villages, Dalits are not permitted to enter into panchayat buildings. In 12% of the villages, Dalits are forced to form separate line at polling booths. In 48% of the villages, Dalits are denied access to water resources. In market access, 35% of the villages, Dalits are banned from selling produce in the local market. 47% of the village milk cooperatives prevent Dalits from selling milk, and 25% from buying milk. The questions persist as to why Dalits have poor access to resources, which directly or indirectly determine the level of income and capabilities to secure other resources of income. Why is the ownership of agricultural land or non-land capital assets low compared to non-Dalits? Why are the unemployment rates are high, particularly among the Dalits, compared to non-Dalits? Why are the daily wage earnings of scheduled caste and scheduled tribe in non-farm activities low compared with non-Dalits? Why is the Dalit literacy rate and education levels are much lower when compared to non-Dalits? From the preceding discussions, we may conclude that the concept of social exclusion is a process of blocking the development of marginal communities, disintegrating people and communities into mainstream of development with a series of institutionalized social systems. The most affected population is Dalits, who lag in all spheres of developmental activities. Dr. Ambedkar, therefore, with his visionary mission, provided a comprehensive framework for the development of people in general, Dalits in particular. Given the complexity and crucial relevance of these issues to large groups of people, the issue we are presently discussing assumes greater significance. The establishment of social exclusion programs of study in various institutions holds the promise of more specialized knowledge to overcome the challenges posed to government, especially in post-colonial era. Even if the government action is tardy, as it is of, as it often is, such knowledge matters because exclusion from the domain of knowledge means preserving exclusion. The field of research it opens up allows for a critical re-examination of current theories and frameworks of understanding social exclusion through such possibility is only gestured in my presentation. Given the diversities of processes and experiences of exclusion, the Indian context has immense potential to contribute to critical broadening of the field of social exclusion. Thank you.
I thank Professor Yagati Chinnarao for this enlightening and in-depth.
Did I speak long?
Hello?
Did I speak long? Hello?
No, sir. It was perfect.
Okay.
It was perfect. Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Yes, loud and clear.
Yes. So I thank Chinnarao for this enlightening and in-depth talk on the subject of social exclusion. So now I open the floor for questions. Like the participants can either unmute yourself and go ahead and ask the question, or if you can chat, if you can type in the chat box, I will read out the question to the speaker. So any one of the two, either you can unmute yourself and ask the question, or you can type in the chat box. Please feel free to go ahead and ask the questions. There is a remark from Ms. Shivani Kumari. Yeah, please go ahead and ask. Okay, you can type the question.
You want to see the panel? You want to see the panel?
Sir, I think the participant will take some time to
type
the question. So
no problem.
Before
no
that,
problem.
I have a question. So I hope I can go ahead with this.
What is that? Go ahead.
Yes.
Or maybe so, all our participants are, you know, enlightened, so they don't have a question, or maybe they are just thinking. So before they think the difficult questions, you can ask me easy question.
Yes, sir. So my question was very general. Like we see post 1990s, as you are saying, with all these acts like the SCST Atrocity Act and acts came into place. But after post 90s, we could see there was an increased engagement of Dalits in the political sphere as well as in the social sphere.
Mm.
Post 90s, it was visible in India. So, so what was the reason? We can see like more number of cases being reported under the POA Act, and Dalits coming out more in public as well as I told, in the political sphere. So, what happened? Like, what were the changes or which happened that post 90s we could see this increased engagement or political activities of the Dalits in India?
Yeah, it is. That's basically on two ways. Number one, see, if you look at the number of cases in various states, you will, one thing is that public awareness.
Yes, sir.
Second thing is that NGO, you know, coming up, you know, hundreds of NGOs coming up on each state. And third is that the public awareness.
Okay.
And because the earlier, if there is a case in Tamil Nadu, unless and until the report comes, our newspaper wishes to publish and are like nobody other, no other knows, no one else. But whereas these days you have this public media, electronic media particularly. So anywhere, any atrocity that is occur, and more so after coming of these, you know, new media sites, WhatsApp message, WhatsApps and all these things, Facebook, etc. So these are number one. And second thing is that some of the states, for example, like you don't see SCST atrocity cases in West Bengal for about, till 1970s and 80s. Because for them, it is not, caste atrocity is not an atrocity, that is a class war. So for example, like Bihar or Rajasthan or UP, raping a Dalit woman or amputing any part of the body of a Dalit person is not considered as a crime. But whereas they used to think that like it is their caste right for the upper caste. So invariably the police doesn't make any complaints. So we don't get to see at all. So this is one reason. Because the studies that I referred in my lecture, it is the studies were conducted in after the 21st century beginning. It's not that 19th century, 18th century. Hello, somebody's interrupting.
Yes.
Yeah. So the medium of communication and the these many TV channels these days, you will get anything that is reported. So let me give you the the 5-year-old case of within JNU. So the a Bhumiyar boy who proposed to a girl in JNU, she's not a Dalit, but one or two stretches lesser than the boy caste. So he couldn't bear it that a lower caste girl, not even a lower caste in the sense Dalit girl, a lower caste than himself, How dare she could deny my proposal? And in the middle of the class, even he attempted to kill her with an axe. And if this is the situation of 21st century, I mean, how the caste, casteness is imbibed with birth, because of you are born in an upper caste. Yeah, go ahead. Any other? Jean Clenta.
Yeah, I have this remark, and now my microphone is also working. Can I say?
Yeah, please.
Sir, I just want to know that what did you say about the term social exclusion? Did you say that it was first introduced in 1974? Because I have read in French classes that it was Jean Clamfort who wrote in 1965 an article, Etude de la marginalité dans les sociétés occidentales. So I think he was the first who first introduced this term social exclusion in France, if I'm not wrong.
No, Jean Clanker.
Jean Clamfer.
What is the spelling? I haven't come across any till now. Where was it published?
1965.
No, but where it was published?
That I don't know. I just know the title of the...
I haven't come across this. It's as far as the current social science literature is concerned, it was emerged, and in the sense, let me tell you two things here, Shivani.
Yeah.
The one thing is that, like, India doesn't accept anything if that there is a discrimination in India or the exclusion in India unless it comes from the West.
Yeah.
Because we have this colonial hangover still.
Yeah.
Okay. Whether you like it or not, this is not my experience. Maybe you can enlighten me if you know. So despite there is a discrimination, despite there is a social excluded groups on the basis of caste or ethnicity, or just to give you more examples of what could be the more sensitive reason to some of the atrocities on northeastern people in the plain areas of, like, whether it's Delhi or other areas. So similarly, but I'll certainly look into, but I am not able to get what you are saying. Maybe your spelling is wrong. I'm just checking on the other computer. Jean Clanker is not coming at all. Please correct me.
Okay, I'll send you the name later. I'll just write the name.
Yeah. Because I haven't come across this. And in the as far as the European Union concerned, like, French was the first one. Because by late 70s, even 1/10 of their population, it seems that they are socially excluded.
Yeah.
Group. Mm-hmm. So from the after that, after French, all these European governments started establishing a separate department called the Combating the Social Exclusion Department. You have it in Germany, you have it in Denmark, you have it in France, you have it in other places.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Okay,
so as far as the Jean Clanker, whatever that you're saying, this is for it, but I haven't come across, and I'll be happy if you can send me the difference.
Okay, sir. Okay, I'll send you the text also.
Okay, done.
Thank you.
So there is the government has been trying to project the face of growth through many high profile projects, but on the other hand, social exclusion still persist. How can the country progress if such systems are not eliminated, shedding the economic growth? Tatanglaka au. Yes, you are right. So that's what exactly I'm trying to say, that the government actions were tardy. And because just imagine, we have reservations, except for political reservations of parliamentary elections or the assembly. Note, even after 70 years of our independence, and tomorrow we are going to celebrate 71st day of Indian Constitution enactment. And no department, no section, no government ever bother to fulfill the reservations. So the social level of this Alvo L. Jimbo, the how does the social exclusion causes greater levels of poverty? Because if you are not allowing the these excluded communities to study or to allow the educational institutions, they are not eligible to good jobs and they'll remain in low poverty and menial jobs, and hence the high level of poverty is one small best example for you. See, there is another one, N. Chang Sang. As per the present scenario, what percentage?
Sir, there is one question.
Yeah. Yeah, tell me. Yes. Go ahead, Dipanjan.
No, sir, I was reading the same question, sir.
Like, yeah.
I was just informing you there's a question. So
Yeah. That's what exactly I'm just trying to answer now. So, because it's just one simple example that I just gave him. If you don't allow them to education institutions, or making them to sit separately, or not allowing them to midday meal schemes, the question in the context of India, do you think that affirmative action is the best measure that can take and empower the history of oppression of all? Yeah, it's but no, the affirmative action is one of the measure that can start to begin with, not the measure I was talking about. So they are the for centuries of oppression, not one day or one year or one decade. Because even now, if you just ask the plain societies, maybe you being at the Nagaland may not be so familiar, but if you come to plain areas, then you would feel the heat of the caste or heat of the this exclusion. Just go for a house rental, any area. See what they would ask first, what caste you belong to, if your name doesn't reveal your caste. And some of the places, at least in South India, places like Hyderabad, etc., they even two-let boats, they mentioned that like, this house will be rented only to Brahmins. So these are some of these examples which comes immediately. Yeah, anything else?
So any other questions or queries?
Any question, comment, anything, you're welcome.
Yeah, if there are no questions or comments, we can wind up the session.
Yeah. So,
I guess there are no more questions. Yes, there is one more question, sir.
Yeah. What is that? Let me just see. Theorize experiences of exclusion. See, the as far as the theorizing the experiences of exclusion is concerned, like as I told you just now in my presentation, there are the five theories that are four or five theories that are available in front of us. Now, to make it more clear to you, the US United States developed a research methodology to study the racial discrimination. And on the basis of the same methodology, Indian social scientists applied the research, what you call methodology, what they developed to study the racial discrimination and to study the caste discrimination in India. And one of its first study of under that part is the there's a book called Blocked by Caste. It was edited by Sukhdev Thoret and Catherine Newman. It was published by OUP in 2010. And there is an another book that developed on the basis of applying for the same research methodology that they studied. It is Vani K. Barua. It is published by SAGE in 2015. That is the book on caste discrimination and exclusion. So these are the two volumes that are so far available of studies in India conducted how the caste discrimination works. So these are the two major works that we have it in India, and no other book so far that at least I come across. Vidya Sagar Sharma, is that okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I think yes, sir. Thanks. Yes, so I think we can. There were quite a few questions and good discussion we had in the question answer session. So I think it's time we can wind up the session.
Okay.
So I once again thank Professor Yagati Chinnara for accepting a request to deliver a lecture for the Department of History at Texas College, and we are very much grateful and thankful to you, sir. And I also thank other faculty and students who attended attended today's webinar. Thank you, everyone. Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you, Deepanjan. See you.
Yes.
Bye bye.
Thank you.
Okay.